Welcome back to the show. We are shooting from Brownie's guest house in Nakuru. And before we went on break, Tabby, you talked to us and you told us about how you attempted suicide 3 times. Mm-hmm. How were you able to rise above the challenge, mm-hmm. or the suicidal challenge? Mm-hmm. And how are you now?
For me, after the third attempt, I think at that moment, I now started serving the Lord really passionately. So I decided to stop concentrating on the boyfriend, because the boyfriend was the one who was making people to talk a lot about me. And I decided to read and serve the Lord. So I served the Lord in class. I was at King's Academy. Cheers to all the teachers who taught me there. And for Deliverance Church, it was a good place. I would pray at the corner for 15 minutes in the morning, noon, in the evening. Yeah, it was a wonderful place. When I went to high school, Butere Girls High School, I served now more crazily. My first 1 month in high school, I preached in all classes, like a small form one, and I used to do my skirt high waist, and I would preach to the, I started with the form fours. And in high school, I served the Lord. Every year after year, up to form four. After now form four, when I came out of school, now is when I said, now this ministry thing has to continue. How? We started talking with some of my friends, their pastor's kids, and we thought, maybe we should organize a camp. I had once seen a camp, a pastor's kids camp. I was that thing in King's Academy, and I liked it. So we thought, we can do that one like a PK camp that is interdenominational.
What is PK?
Pastor's kids. Mm. So we decided to do a pastor's kids camp. And we said, because we want the legacy, you know, the mark that our parents have left to continue after they are long gone, we will call it legacy. So we said we will have a legacy PK camp. We did the first one in 2013-15 in attendance, 5 pastor's kids. We enjoyed ourselves for the 3 days. And the next year we did another one. We could not get enough pastor's kids to attend. So from the second year, I started doing it as a youth camp. The third year, we again did the camp as a youth camp. Now, after the third year, the team now that we were working together, we decided we will now do a mobilization strategy. We start doing keshas around the country, legacy keshas and legacy weekends and all that. So by the fourth year, at least we had gone to many places, Narok, Turbo, Nairobi, we were doing keshas. But at that point, at the fourth camp, I gave up. I just quit. I just felt like the ministry is not going the way I am. I'm putting in effort. I'm not seeing the results I want. We were still having 20 people in the camp, 30, and it's after 4 years. I'm thinking, am I really in the right track? So I said, after that camp, I will quit. I won't continue. And at that point, there was a strike in my campus, so they told us to go home. I was at home for 8 months during that strike, and I said, I will not serve in this legacy thing. Ministry, I couldn't end as if fine, but I serve God in my local church. So I was serving in my local church, but challenges got me there still. And now that's the time I fell into depression.
Before you tell us about the depression, mm-hmm. that you fell into, mm-hmm. what were your expectations as you started Legacy? What mm-hmm. were your expectations that were not met?
My expectations I wanted to gather a lot of young people. And I expected support, a lot of support from the people I was working with, from churches. You know, me, I'm just having a noble idea of gathering young people. Send them with the cash. You know, I really wanted to see many young people attend our camps. But I
How old were you then?
I was 21, 22. When we started the camps, I was 20. So I wanted to do something big for the Lord. And I would have big thoughts and big visions. And then the camp will come and become, that fourth year, I did good posters, you know. I did good. If I had money, I would have gone on TV then. So, but now the numbers are not adding up. Especially that fourth year. On the day the camp was starting, two children who were coming to the camp died in an accident. They were from our church, they died in an accident. The same day, at least three ministers that I had invited to minister in the camp withdrew. They withdrew at the last minute. Some of the people we were organizing with also said, we cannot make it, it's after Christmas. So they withdrew. Now, with the effort I had put in that year, I just said, I want this camp to end, and God just know I will never do this again. I was so disappointed. My parents supported me. They gave me the finances. My sisters helped, like Mercy, my big sister, during that camp, she led worship from the one to the last day. She led worship as if she was ministering to 100 people. And I had most of the people who attended that camp were my relatives, at least 10 of them. And then 15 were from others. So you're around 25 or 30. And my parents and family showed me support, but I was still feeling, God, you have disappointed me. People have disappointed me. I'm not doing this anymore. And so when I quit, I was ministering at the church. I said, the challenges are too many, you know. And I said, let me minister to a few people at least. The challenges will be less. Now the devil looked for me. I even started a business. Nkaanza kupika chapo because we were at home. We started doing chapatis with another friend of mine. And we were at Rosia to Amje. You can imagine what people are saying. Pastor, I'm a salt and mpaka mtoto anapika chakula. But I didn't want to be idle. So after 1 month, I was having money, but I was not happy. I was having a lot of money, that kind of business. By the way, young person, don't just stay at home. You can do something.
Tabi, do you think your age, that particular time, your age and your passion contributed to the depression? Because maybe, what can you say?
Yeah, it contributed a lot. My age and my passion. You know, I love to do the work of God. Ministry, I love God and I love ministry. And there's a difference between ministry and loving God. And also, I'm growing up. Okay? So, when friends, there was something that happened, especially that year, with some of my very close friends, and we parted ways. And now, the ministry, the expectations I had, I just felt so disappointed. And so I said, I will withdraw. How can I say it? A go-getter.
Yeah, you're a go-getter.
Not just a go-getter, but I'm this kind. I don't sit and watch. I am proactive. Mm-hmm. I don't wait for things to happen. I make them happen, you know. I am the storm. And so I always make things happen for people. And I would I'm giving myself to them. They're not giving, they don't even care what happens to me after I've given myself to the ministry to be concerned, to pray for them. Nobody wants to pray for me. Nobody wants to know how I'm doing. So I just said, away with it. And I withdrew from people, and I would minister, then withdraw. I'm not talking to anybody about what I'm feeling. So I'll go at home, cry on Mondays from morning to evening. My mom will ask me, why are you crying this way? I'm telling her, the spirit of the Lord of intercession is upon me, mom. I'm praying, I'm groaning in the spirit. Because she knows me, she would believe. I didn't want them to know that they knew I'm feeling bad, but I didn't want them to know the extent of the pain I'm feeling in my heart because of the other challenges that they face as ministers. So most of my life, I never wanted my parents to know that I am in pain because I know the challenges they face in ministry. So I did not want to be a pain to them. That's why I lied to my mother. Mom, forgive me. So I withdrew from people. I tried to be in a certain relationship, it also didn't work out well. And I just said, to hell. So I had a lot of bitterness and anger in my heart. And the Bible says that when you fail to forgive, the man who failed to forgive in Luke 18 was handed over to the oppressors. So because of their unforgiveness and the bitterness I had in my heart against friends, people, and all that, the oppressor called depression came to me, and I didn't know. I would have dark nights. I could not sleep. I would cry during the days, no sleep at night. And I stayed that way my week Monday to Saturday would be like that. I would attend praise and worship practice like that. And I'd pretend I'm okay, go back to depression. Sunday come and minister in worship seriously, dance like madness. Go back to Mondays were my worst. But then I reached a point and realized I'm not okay. I need to seek the face of God on another level. So I decided to do a Daniel fast. You know, some people despise Daniel fast. They think it's too easy or something. But it's not easy. Try it. I did it for 21 days. And on the 20th day, I started feeling an opening in my heart. And that's when the Lord just showed me that I'm just bitter. It's anger and bitterness that have brought me to that place. So I started now like trying to forgive some things I thought were unforgivable. How could somebody do that to me? How could you, God, even forgiving God, how could you neglect me and the way I'm giving myself to this thing? And June, July, that's around the time I birthed my purpose. Immediately after the depression, I thank God because the suicide thought never hit my head when I was depressed. But most people are depressed, they always think of suicide. But because I had gone through that suicide road, it could not come. That spirit did not come to me. I just felt, if God wants me, he will take me. I will not kill myself, but I'm not okay. I was not okay. I knew I'm not okay. And I sought the face of God. I wish right now I would tell somebody, if you think you're depressed, pray and get a counselor. It will make it easier.
Talk to someone.
Yes.
So what pushed you, mm-hmm. Tabby, to do what you're doing right now? Mm-hmm. And kindly tell us what you're doing with yourself right now.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I've been doing the ministry for pastor. I was just doing camps and events because I want to serve the Lord. I can serve the Lord in any capacity. I didn't know why I'm doing what I'm doing. And I really wanted to know. That year, 2017, I really wanted to know why I'm doing what I'm doing. So it came through pain. Yes. So after the depression, I also tried out a few to relationships. I'm growing up, please understand. Don't judge me. Don't judge me, okay? So I tried out another relationship and I realized the Jama was joking. He was not serious. And me, I took him seriously. And it really pained me. So I decided to do another prayer to that effect. When I was praying, God revealed me my purpose. I was happy.
Tell us about your purpose.
My purpose is to call young people to passionately love God, know their identity in Christ, and fulfill their purpose on earth. Loving God. Pastor's kid, young person, don't just go to church. Love the Lord with all your heart. Life will not be easy. If you don't love God, if you're leaning on your dad's salvation, when situations come, dad will not be there. My dad was not with me in campus. I would have done whatever I wanted, but I loved the Lord. So I'm calling young people not just to be religious, to love the Lord with all our hearts, with everything, because God loved us. Number two, know your identity in Christ. Know who you are. Most of the things I went through is because I didn't really know who I am in Christ. I also didn't understand issues of personality and I didn't have a knowledge of myself, let me say, just understanding myself also as a woman. You know, I've had to learn to understand myself as a woman because of my outgoing nature. Sometimes I used to think like a man, the boy of the house. So identity and understanding themselves, especially in Christ. And then all these other things will follow. And then knowing your purpose and fulfilling it. Every great man is a man who knows their purpose. Jesus said, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and finish his work. Paul said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. You must know which fight you're fighting. You cannot live life. He said, I do not fight like a, you know, ignorant man, beating the air. No, I have a focus. There's somewhere I'm going. If you know your purpose, you will not try to commit suicide. Every time that voice comes, because the devil, even like last year again, I went into my depression, but I would tell the devil, shame on you. I know why God has kept me alive up to today. Because of purpose, you cannot commit suicide. You know why you are there. You will live long and you will live meaningfully.
Yeah. And you have to speak to yourself every day for you to get to your purpose.
True, true.
So that you remind yourself.
Yes.
Any upcoming meetings with pastors' kids yes. and the youth?
Oh, nice, nice, nice. So for the past 6 years, we've done 5 years, we've done 6 camps, but we didn't have pastors' kids as such exclusively. So by the grace of God recently, there's a PK department in my church, KAG. Thank you, Bishop Mungai. He appointed me to head the PK department. So in the month of August, we'll organize an exclusive PK camp. We'll give the dates. You can follow me on Facebook, Tabitha Nyando, and the details will be there for the camp for the pastor's kids. At the end of the year, also I'll launch a book.
Wow. Yes. You're writing a book?
Yeah.
What about?
Passionately loving God, knowing your identity in Christ, fulfilling your purpose on earth. It is a workbook that a young person, a pastor's kids can go through for 3 months mm-hmm. in a group. Yes.
Any upcoming meetings for the youth?
For the youth, basically from August now from the camp, we'll have breakfast. If you follow me on Tabitha, on Facebook, Tabitha Nyando, you'll get all the details there. Yes.
Tabitha, I want you to look at the camera.
Yes.
And I want you to speak to a young person mm-hmm. that is struggling with love, mm-hmm. struggling with identity.
Yes.
They don't know who they are. Mm-hmm. And we are living in a very, in very dark times mm-hmm. where most young people don't know who they are, mm-hmm. Their identity, especially yes. like you've said, in Christ. Mm-hmm. That's the most important identity. Yes. When you know who you are in Christ, you are able to fulfill, to know who you are also mm-hmm. in regards to the calling, mm-hmm. maybe in the marketplace, yeah. or other places.
Yes.
And I want you to look at the camera mm-hmm. and speak to a young person mm-hmm. as your parting shot. What mm-hmm. would you tell them?
My parting shot would be that God is for you. If God be for you, who can be against you? Are you a pastor's kid? Are you a young person and you're wondering, do people really care? We care. God cares, God loves you. Please don't walk alone. Mentors have helped me a lot. I want to acknowledge Apostle Karanja, Prophet Elijah, and all the other. My parents have mentors. And also, when you have mentors, please submit. Young people don't submit. They don't listen. Please listen to your pastors. Listen to Pastor Ruth. Let's listen to the men of God. As they pray for you and give you sound counsel, please listen to it. And remember, God loves you. I have a playlist that's called Loved, Beloved. I listen to it when I'm feeling down. In the morning, I listen to it and remind myself, God loves me. And because God loves me, I will know who I am in Him. As you read the Bible, have the consciousness, not of God wanting to punish you, but the consciousness of God loving you. And if permitted, I will pray with the pastor's kids
Please
and the do. Pastors.
Please do.
And God will bring us through. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank mm-hmm. you for every listener and watcher, oh God, from wherever they are. I pray for the ministers of the gospel. They sacrifice a lot, oh God, to see that the gospel is propagated. May you strengthen them in Jesus' name. Thank you for their children, oh God. They have to sacrifice. They have to grow in the midst of many things, oh God. May you also help them, oh God, to know that you love them.
Yes,
to
Lord.
Know who they are mm-hmm. in you, oh God, and to understand that they are not on earth in vain. In Jesus' name. Father, we pray for all the young people, oh God, in the midst of the depression and suicide rates, in the midst, oh God, of single motherhood in these days, oh King of Glory, mm. promiscuity, oh God, and all the other challenges you are facing, financial challenges, oh God, mm-hmm. may you help them to know themselves in you so that they may go through these challenges and be overcomers, because whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. Right mm. now, I declare them overcomers. Mm-hmm. I declare the grace to overcome mm-hmm. and I declare testimonies upon testimonies will come forth to mm-hmm. the glory and honor of your name. Mm-hmm. In Jesus' name we pray and believe.
In Jesus' name. And Tabitha, before we go, I'm thinking, why don't you organize a pastor's conference mm-hmm. and bring in the pastor's kids mm-hmm. that have made it mm-hmm. to speak to the pastors so that the pastors can know how to bring up their children.
All right.
We are coming to you from Brownies in Nakuru. For all your weddings, for all your anniversaries, group meetings, you are welcome to this place. For more information, look out for Brownies on the website in Nakuru. God bless you. Keep watching Total Woman. Keep pushing forward. You are a very powerful woman.
And go through Total Woman. Got potential.